Triton College presents Chicago Celebrities with your host, Mel Novit.
Hi, during these times of treachery and hypocrisy, who can we turn to find out the real story about the animals in this country? For me, I turned Uncle Lair, and I'd like to say welcome, Larry Lujack, and say, what has happened to this puppy? And what have happened to you? I mean, you've been mud wrestling with this dog?
Yeah, the dog won the fight, obviously.
The dog won the...
Dog bit my ankle.
Dog bit the ankle, but what happened to the dog's ankle here is what I want to know.
I bit him back. I don't take anything from not even cute little animals like that.
I have to ask you a question, Larry. Everybody knows you for your animal stories. I mean, I'm sure you look at something like that. You really want to know the story behind this. I'm not going to tell you until the end of this taping, but where do you usually get your stories?
I just know, what's wrong with that dog's ear? I just noticed the ear. There's something wrong with the ear, too.
Well, when I stepped on the dog's foot, the ear went back. A very angry dog. And she doesn't want to get off stage.
It's about 50-50. 50% of the stuff is sent in by listeners, and the other 50% we find in newspapers and magazine articles and so forth.
Do you actually select the stories yourself?
Yeah. And I open all the mail so that when little Tommy hears the stories, he is hearing them for the first time, just like the audience. When we first started out, I would show him the stories first, but we found out that didn't work as well. It's not as spontaneous, and so now I open all the mail, and he hasn't heard the stories either when they finally hit the air.
Why do you often refer to him as snot-nosed little Tommy?
Because the first day that he started doing the show with me, he had a really bad cold, and he was... It was disgusting.
Larry, I laughed and laughed when I read your biography, which I suspect you had a great deal to do with writing. And I want to read one of your own, well, it's partly your own quote and partly something somebody else wrote. The walls of his office at home are covered with DJ of the Year awards, all of them, he claims, richly deserved. Never one to plead modesty, Larry says, quote, I am not conceited or egotistical. I am just plain fantastic. Larry... Everybody agrees with that, but what is it that makes you so fantastic? What do you do, all kidding aside, that makes you so special on the air?
All kidding aside, Mel, I was just metaphysically predestined for eternal greatness.
Metaphysically predestined.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not even sure I know what predestined
means. I don't either. I just thought it sounded good. I thought I'd throw it out. I don't know. I think... I've just been lucky. If I were to sit down and count the number of disc jockeys that have gone through this town in the years that I've been here since 1967, this is my 15th year, I'd need an adding machine to add them all up. Obviously, I think one has to have X amount of talent. But I think just as important, maybe more so, is just being lucky. And I've always been lucky.
Do you feel that, just as it was when you started out, that the bass, profundo voice is still the most important thing in being a radio announcer?
Oh, certainly, Bill. Not really. There are guys with good voices, and there are guys with mediocre voices. That used to be one of the primary requisites, you know, for a job in broadcasting was the voice. I don't think that's true anymore. There are a lot of lightweight voices, without mentioning names, that are very successful. It's along with X amount of talent and a hell of a lot of luck, I think... There's also an intangible something that you either have or you don't have. And if you don't have it, no amount of teaching will do any good. It's you either got it or you don't. whatever that intangible is, I don't know.
Based on your biography, Larry, you've got it, because you say you're rated the number one, that you are the super jack, and super jack is a copywritten term. How are disc jockeys rated? I mean, who rated you that way, and on what basis were you rated?
Well, the ratings, you could talk forever about how accurate the ratings are.
Describe what they are, first of all. Who does the ratings?
Well, in radio, there are several outfits. The primary one, the one that most of the advertising agencies go by, is the ARB, or Arbitron. And they select a certain number of homes, ask these people to keep diaries of their listening habits, and from that, they figure out how many people are listening to what station. Now, how accurate they are, I don't know. I don't think there is... ratings are a necessary evil. I don't think they're all that accurate, but we have to go by something. And
all right now, you are rated number one. How many listeners does that mean in any given hour?
I don't have the faintest idea.
You have no idea?
No.
How do you know that anybody out there is listening? What sense of that do you get when you're in the studio?
Well, you could tell. You know, at least the people on the phones are listening. The reason I don't know is because WLS is a 50,000-watt... clear channel station, and we're going into several states. So
what states are you going into?
A lot, especially early in the morning before a lot of the daytimers sign on. We get letters from Texas and Florida and up in Canada.
Really?
And Pennsylvania and all over the place.
So they know the Larry Lujack show?
Yeah,
the whole time
a lot of our animal stories come from articles clipped out of papers in weird places like Hayes, Kansas, and stuff like that, where people are picking up the show. So I really have no idea. It's in the millions, but I don't know how many.
Right. Obviously, you've been very successful here in Chicago, but before your tremendous success here, how many times were you fired at other radio stations, and why?
I think I was fired 4 times. In the early days of my career, and basically all of them were for the same reason, that being that I was young and stupid, and a lot of times I would say things before I really thought about what I was saying. And
on the air?
Yeah.
Can you give me an example of one of those silly things?
In Spokane, I got fired over a Volkswagen commercial because it was a weird commercial. The first part of it was on tape, and part of it was in the German language, and it started out Achtung like that, and it sounded like something you'd hear on Hogan's Heroes or something. And then they switched over to English, and then I had a live tag to deliver, and I said, I forget what I said exactly, but the Volkswagen dealer in Spokane heard it and thought that I was somehow trying to imply that his Volkswagen dealership was really a cover for some sort of underground Nazi movement in this country. So he was going to sue me and sue the station and sue everybody, and the station figured they could get him off their backs if they just lopped off my head, which they proceeded to do.
You tend to be a lot more careful now.
Oh, yeah. After you get better at it. As the years go by, you realize that you can say just about anything you want to say as long as it is worded correctly. And so now I'm very careful about how I word things, and I don't really get in a lot of trouble anymore.
Now, what about this morning? I heard you referring to Lonnie Anderson's boobs. I take it there's a lot more liberty for you to say the things you'd like to say and tell it like it is?
There's nothing wrong with boobs. What kind of a prude are you?
Not hers, but you know, I was a little shocked.
Besides, I don't think I said boobs. I think I said humongous hooters.
That was the second time. I'd like to talk to you about your audience that may consist of other prudes like myself in my age range. People that started out listening to you, what, 10, 15 years ago, you were in Chicago also?
67, yeah.
67, so that's 72. You can make me add it up right here on the air, 15 years ago. Who was your audience then? I mean, you were rock and roll then, and you're rock and roll now, I believe. Who was your audience then as compared to now?
I think that a lot of those people who were listening as kids then, we were a lot more rock and rolly in those days than we are now. I think now WLS is more of a mass appeal type station. I think now we're the primary demographic target we're after now is like 24 to 49, whereas in those days it was a lot younger, like 18 to 25.
But those
like
people
that.
Then would fall into that age.
Right. Those people grew up and had kids, and their kids are listening, and so are their parents. So it's working out just swell.
You think rock and roll is here to stay, though? I mean, you still play a significant amount.
Yeah. I plan to be still here playing these silly Led Zeppelin records when their grandchildren
let me read
get old enough.
One of your other wonderful quotes about how you feel about this music. His favorite, now he says his, but I have a feeling, Larry, you may have written this yourself. His favorite kind of music is, quote, real loud rock and roll, the kind that makes your liver quiver, your teeth ache, your eyeballs roll, and your brains run out your nose. His favorite singer is country rocker Waylon Jennings, and I have to add this in, it's not really related, but his pet peeve is idiots who ask me what my pet peeve is, and he says his favorite color is black lace. But getting away from that last statement, what do you think about the new rock and roll, some of this stuff with gunshots in it, and I mean the really crazy acid stuff? Are you into that at all?
You talking about new wave or punk rock, is that it?
There's one group that just did street songs, not a group. The name escapes me. I'm not as up on this music being.
Well, there's some real sick stuff out there. When a rock band calls itself the Dead Kennedys, I'm sorry, but I gotta get off. That's too sick. A lot of the so-called new wave music, well, of course, we're not playing it, and hardly anybody else is. And it's just, I don't think it will last.
How much discretion do you have if some group, for example, comes out calling themselves the Dead Kennedys? Can you say, as Larry Lujack, I don't want this being played?
No. Oh, I can say it. Wouldn't do any good.
Wouldn't do any
disc
good.
Disc jockeys don't pick the music they play anymore.
Who is picking the music?
Computers. Computers are taking over the world, and radio stations are no exception. I come in every morning, and there are several computer sheets that will tell me what songs I will play and in what order.
And I'm assuming that it's based on the most popular songs around and the ones who will attract the most listeners.
Right.
Some of the groups today, what groups won't you play on your, or I shouldn't say won't you, but do you take offense to, let's say if you have to play, considering you're not making the decisions?
Well, I don't think WLS really plays anything that anybody could object to. Like I said before, we are a mass appeal station, theoretically, and our management and our programming and music people are very conservative, and we don't take chances on stuff like that.
All right, I'd like to take our discussion a little bit of a different direction. Years ago, in fact, not that all that many years ago, you'd see a very lonely-looking disc jockey, kind of like Johnny Fever, you know, WKRP Cincinnati, playing all of his own records and doing 20 different things with his two hands. Are you involved in any of the technical at all? I mean, you're actually playing any tapes or any discs, or you just have to sit there and be charming?
I'm sitting there doing as little as possible. There's an engineer on the other side of the glass who pushes all the buttons and does all the hard stuff. I just sit there and try to stay awake every morning and try to be charming and delightful.
Oh, and that you are, mm-hmm. Uncle Larry. Very charming.
Thank you.
In other words, then, is this true all over the country, though, or just a sophisticated station like WLS here in Chicago? If somebody,
no,
the reason I'm asking, excuse me, if somebody were to break into it today, do they have to be prepared to do all of these things?
Oh, yeah, for sure. That's just in major markets where you have engineers. In fact, all of the stations that I worked at prior to Chicago, I was doing all that stuff myself. But radio was really a lot more fun then, because I can remember back in the days when I was working in Seattle in the early 60s, when we actually got to pick out the records we played and stuff. And that was a lot more fun. Now it's... you're really just kind of a robot in there, you know, the computer.
How does that make you feel? having done it all and then becoming a robot.
Depressed until I realized that the checks here are a lot bigger than the checks were in Seattle, and then I'm not depressed anymore.
But wouldn't you compare yourself to what people are calling the news readers on TV, people that are calling themselves journalists and virtually just sitting there reading the news, and you are Superjock, and yet you're saying that you're just sitting there and feeding out the stuff that they're telling you to. Does that affect you?
I'm basically, Mel, a shallow, greedy person.
I can relate to that.
I'm there for the money. No, it's not really that bad. I wish that I could pick the music I play, but I can't, and so there's no sense getting depressed or worried about it. The rest of the stuff, I'm pretty much allowed to freewheel it as long as I don't say anything that will put the station's license in jeopardy or get myself or the station sued or lose too many big accounts.
What are the delineations? What kind of thing, without saying it on this tape here, could you be sued or thrown off the air for? What kinds of things do you have to avoid?
Well, like that Volkswagen thing, you can't go implying that some Volkswagen dealership is an underground Nazi movement, obviously.
What about sexual words? How far can you go today without getting too explicit? I'm a prude.
Well, it's all in how it's worded. We obviously can't use terms that are considered obscene. However, I'm not sure that you couldn't get away with that as far as the FCC is concerned, because the FCC doesn't really crack down on what some might consider obscene lyrics, because there have been some court cases on that, and they've determined that that's artistic expression.
Freedom
and
of speech.
Right, right. So I'm not sure that we couldn't say, if we wanted to, just about anything we wanted to say, but the problem is that you would sure lose a lot of listeners real fast. You would offend, huge numbers of people.
So it's important to you as to numbers. How important is it to you in terms of knowing a lot of people are listening, in other words, relating it to ratings? Do you guide yourself according to ratings?
Yeah, it's my job. That's how important it is, because there are literally millions of dollars in advertising revenue that ride on those ratings. And whether or not they're accurate or not, who knows? But it's that's the way the business is. And that's why there is no such thing as job security in radio, or really any branch of the entertainment business, as long as you're in the performing end. It's not like a lot of jobs where if you go in every day and you show up on time and you work very hard and you're a very dedicated, conscientious employee, in a lot of career fields you won't have any problems with that. In this business, it doesn't make any difference how nice a guy you are, how hard you work. If you don't cut it in the ratings, that's going to cost the radio station thousands and thousands, perhaps millions of dollars in advertising revenue. And so it doesn't make any difference how nice a guy you are, how hard you work. They're going to get somebody who can.
After 15 years of being a success here in Chicago, and have you been with LS, by the way, all these 15 years?
All but four.
Okay, so you've been there 11 years. Do you feel any more secure? Is that actors' insecurity or performers' insecurity gone after all these years?
To some extent, because I have achieved something that is very rare in this business, and that is a non-cancelable contract.
Chicago cannot get rid of you.
That's not for a while, anyway. But that's very rare in the business. But I have been here for a long time, and the people who I work for trust me, and so they give me that because they know I'm not going to screw up. But most guys don't have something like that. I mean, they can be fired with 6 weeks' notice.
Literally, you have a lifetime contract, which means that if they decided we don't want Larry Lujack anymore, it's kind of like a Milton Berle kind of deal where they'd have to pay you the rest of your life.
Did I say lifetime? I don't recall using that term.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I said it's non-cancelable.
Oh, non-cancelable.
For a while.
For a while. Well, how long is a while?
This one has another 3 years.
3 years.
On.
Okay. Yeah. Well, hopefully that's not a lifetime. Larry, I noticed you've been branching out a lot lately, and I've been watching your television commercials, and you're complaining that you're not getting any respect, any more than Rodney Dangerfield. And by the way, they're terrific. you have a wonderful presence in television. Are you thinking along those lines, like Bob Surratt? Are you going to maybe make a change?
No. I really have no interest in television. I don't really have a whole lot of interest in radio anymore either. I just like to play golf. No, there's nothing really that I want to do anymore. I've achieved, in fact, surpassed all the goals that I originally set. And so now I don't know what the next step is, because I don't want to get on TV and, run some dippy game show or...
What goals did you originally set that you've surpassed?
Well, when I was a disc jockey in Caldwell, Idaho, I thought Boise was the big time. And if I could ever make it to Boise, that would be it. So then I made it to Boise, and then I was thinking Spokane would be the ultimate. And then after Spokane, I wanted to make it in Seattle. And then after Seattle, I decided to try for Chicago. But now I got nowhere to go.
Come on. You just got back from the Big Apple. You were there yesterday.
Yeah, but whenever I go to New York, it's on business, and I get in and out as fast as I can because I hate that place. And I have no desire. I've had offers to work in New York, but I don't like big cities. I don't like Chicago that much. So you really live
outside of the city limits,
in the
suburbs. Doing these TV commercials, can I assume these are your idea? Are they management's idea?
No, if they were mine, they would have been a lot better.
I think they're terrific the way they are. They're your modest kind of guy, despite your biography. I have a question related to these commercials, though. Don't they make you a lot more recognizable on the street?
Yeah, that's a problem, yeah.
It is a problem. You don't want to be recognizable on the street.
Most people, it's not too bad, but there are some real obnoxious people out there roaming the streets, and it gets to be a problem where you can't go into a McDonald's or any place, really, without... That used to be one of the nice things about radio. People heard you, but they never saw you. Now, you know, your face is all over the TV thing, and they've had billboards up in past years and so forth.
Why would you go into a medium that commands attention and then want anonymity? It doesn't seem to make sense.
Well, I didn't go into this because I wanted to be rich and famous or something like that. I got into this by accident because I was looking for a part-time job in college where I was majoring in forestry. Are you ready for that? This is an honest story. I was going into the wildlife conservation end of the forestry department, and I was going to save our nation's wildlife. When I grew up, I was going to work for the Idaho Fish and Game Department and ban ducks and shoot tranquilizer darts in bears and put tags in their ears and stuff like that. And I just got into this business by accident. There was this little bitty radio station in this town where I was going to college that was looking for people who worked real cheap. And at the time, since I was a starving college student, I worked real cheap. I just started working part-time at this radio station and then decided that, gosh, this was a lot more fun than, plus along with that, I found out how much people who work for the Idaho Fish and Game Department got paid, and it sure wasn't very much, so I got kind of discouraged about that, and it seemed to be a good deal where you could sit on your butt and play rock and roll records and get paid for it, so that's how I got into this business. It wasn't because I was... you know, off on some ego trip, and I wanted to be famous and have everybody know who I was.
What if today, Larry, somebody would give you the phenomenal salary that you're making to go and work for the Fish and Game Commission or do this?
In a second. You see, I don't need all that. You see, my car out in the parking lot is a 1978 cow manure brown Monza with four cylinders. You can see these are not exactly... expensive clothes.
Oh, that's a Gucci shirt.
No, it's not. So I don't need all that stuff, and I don't care about any of that stuff.
Well, then how does it make you feel when people make a lot of do-over Larry Lujack walking in?
It's embarrassing.
How do you handle
it? Just fake my way through it the best I can. But it really does get embarrassing. Wherever you go, people are whispering or pointing at you, and it's, I don't know, I just don't like it. I really don't see how people who are really famous, like Paul Newman or Elizabeth Taylor, I don't see how they function.
A lot of people in your business, though, as we both know, love it. They eat it up.
Oh, yeah. There
are a lot of phonies, too. Their image is no more like what they are than the man on the moon. This isn't true of Larry Lujack, obviously. How do you feel about these people in the business? Do you agree that there are a lot of phonies in the business?
Sure, sure. Different strokes for different folks.
Do you avoid these people? You avoid the cocktail?
Like the plague. No, I don't go to parties. I don't drink, and I don't go to parties, and... but all my wife and I do is play golf in the summer and occasionally go skiing in the winter and go to a few movies, and that's it. I don't.
You say you don't drink, and you seem like a clean-cut kind of guy, so I'm assuming...
Check, no needle mark.
Okay,
either.
Okay, you passed the test. How do you feel about your business, or what do you know about it? Is this drug problem pervasive enough to have hit the radio business as well as the other entertainment media?
I don't think it's as serious in radio as it is in some other branches of the entertainment business, but I will say this, and a lot of people in my business would disagree with this, but I'm convinced that it's right, and that is that I think that rock radio has to take a large share of the blame for the drug problem that there is in this country today. Back in the 60s, when complaints were brought up about drug-oriented lyrics in rock songs, the popular cop-out of station managers and program directors was, we're not endorsing the stuff, we're just playing the songs that reflect what's happening in society today. And I think that's garbage. By playing those songs, we endorsed it. We made it seem hip and glamorous and sophisticated. And of course, that's what every kid wants to be, is hip and glamorous and sophisticated. So I don't think you can just lay it on all the blame on rock musicians. I think rock radio stations have to take a large share of the blame. But then that's something you could talk about forever.
Do you feel guilty about having been a part of it?
Not really, because that's one thing. I'm not like a Howard Miller. How long have you been around? Do you remember Howard
Miller?
Long
enough for Howard Miller. And before.
Howard used to get on the air every morning and crusade for something, whatever that morning's thing was. And I don't consider myself a crusader. I'm not there to preach at people.
So then on the flip side of the coin, you're not going to take responsibility either.
But that's one thing I did preach on, and I always have, and I think drugs are really stupid, and people who use drugs are idiots. And that includes Elvis was an idiot, and so was John Belushi, and so were the rest of them. They were stupid people. And go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead.
Well, I guess I was finished with that.
Larry,
go ahead.
Okay. I have one important question, a concluding question. Another quote from the great Larry Lujack, or perhaps one he took from somebody else, I'm not sure. There is no great genius without some touch of madness. Is that your own or somebody else's?
No, that's a Roman philosopher. Okay. Do I look like somebody who could come up with something like that?
Of course you do. It was part of that wonderful biography. Tell me what that means to you and why you've used it in your biography.
Well, that's, I didn't write all that stuff. That is a quote from a sign that is above my desk.
You must believe in the words.
Oh, yeah. I think anybody who excels in their field has got to be different and regarded by some possibly as a little nutso.
Okay, well, with that, I'd like to thank our nutso for today and thank Uncle Larry Lujack. You can watch for or listen for Larry Lujack or watch for him if you'd like on WLS Radio each morning from 6 to 10. I'd like to thank you for joining me on Chicago Celebrities, and please be sure to watch for my next guest.